Ok. So last week, we finished by, well, last week we were providing some example of monoidal category. So we will finish to provide this example. So last week we finished by the example VecG. So today we will start by defining VecG omega. So it's like VecG, but with a slight deformation. So consider, so like VecG, but with deformation. So consider the simple object of VecG. So the simple object of VecG, they are just one-dimensional vector spaces. one-dimensional vector spaces, delta G, such with, so with, so the, you have the grading, so the H component of this is zero if G is different from H, otherwise it is itself G. So this is a Kronecker symbol. Kronecker symbol saying that it is zero if G is different from H, otherwise it's just one. So anyway, so so you see the unit object. It's just that, it's just a field. Then you have the tensor product, which is exactly given by the product on the group. And so in the case of VecG, and associativity constraint A on the simple on the simple object is exactly is just is trivial, the trivial one, as we said. So this is the identity of this space. So it wrote like that. So you start like that and you go like that, you move the parenthesis. But it is exactly the identity. Because this one is delta GHM. This one is delta GHM. So the associativity reduced to the associativity of the group. So trivial. So for so we can deform. So deformation we are looking for is we will make a modification on the associativity constraint. Et as follow to define vec g omega. So for vec g only, this is the identity. So this will be almost the identity up to a multiplicative constant. So now, where is it? Yeah. A delta G, delta H, delta M will be equal to omega GHM identity of delta GHM with omega from G cross Z cross G to K star such that by Pentagon equation, Pentagon axiom, we have the following equation, omega G1, G2, G3, G4 times omega G1, G2, G3, G4. So you should be careful where I put comma, where I put multiplication, equal omega G1, G2, G3, omega G1, G2, G3, G4, finally omega G2, G3, G4. So last semester we proved that using the Pentagon axiom, in fact, it is nothing but just the reformulation. This is just the reformulation of the Pentagon axiom in this particular case. Such an omega is called the three cocycle. Okay. So now so up to now all the category we provided in all the category we provided all the objects can be modelized as a set here a vector space even if there is this deformation. Now, an example where so it's new. Now, an example where the objects are not sets. Vector space is a set. This is the category of tangle. Category of tangle. This is one example where the objects are not set, but you can make all the examples you want. So as many as you want. So here the object are numbers. So a number is not a set. Numbers n non-negative. The morphism. So before talking about the morphism, so the tensor product of object. This is just the product of the addition, not the product, the addition of numbers. The unit just zero, and associativity constraint and the unit morphism are obvious here. And so, what about the morphism, which is the main point, the main interest of this category? So the morphism. Okay. So the morphism. So the set, this set is the set of tangle. Set of tangle up to as below. We will draw a generic one as below up to isotopy. Isotopy means up to deformation, up to good deformation. So so generically, so between n and m, so what is n? So you consider n, you put n point like that, n point. So here I draw a six, but and you put this point in some plane and you go up to m point, and here I will put 8 3 4 5 6 7 8, and you put a string between these points. So can be string between a point on the top and a point on the bottom, or a string between two points on the top, or a string between two points on the bottom. What else? So then what's so what I did? I did something like that, and this is non-planar, so it is a three-dimensional. So that's why I am trying to draw something three-dimensional. 1 2 3 4 1 2 3 4, something like that. Then. Let me see. I can do that properly. So like that. And like that. And finally this one. So you can have string like that, but you can also have string, some free string, which are not connected to a point. can be below below an edge like that, or can be around an edge like that, or it can be completely outside. Okay, so you can see what is so the morphisms are the set of such generic tangle. Anyway, so if you want to see the details of the definition of this tangle, you can go to the book or the last semester course. Maybe last semester I did not do too much details also, but in the book they wrote the details of the definition of that. Anyway, so here, this is in T6 here. And okay, so you can imagine. And so what about the tensor product of morphism? This is just the concatenation. So the tensor product, tensor product of morphism. This is just, so you can call that T. You have T1, you have two morphism lies above. So you have N1. N2, M1, and you have some string in the between. So I will not make tensor product. This is just so you are making here. You put N1 plus M1 dot, N1 plus N2 dot, as for the tensor product of the object. Here, same, M1 plus M2 dot, and in between you put what you had before. Just the concatenation. Okay. So make it clear. T1 tensor, T2 equal like that. Concatenation. Okay. And you have, so what about, you have the identity morphism, which is so the identities morphism are just morphism. We have endpoint, and you are just putting straight line. Straight line. Okay. And the composition is also the concatenation, but the vertical concatenation for the tensor product of morphism. This is a horizontal concatenation and composition of tangle vertical nation as follows. So you have you are making, so you want to compose two. So you have this one is T, so you have something here, something here, something like that, something like that, something like that, something like that, like that, maybe something like that, something like that. Wait. Something here, thanks. Anyway, so this one is in T and M, this one in T M R. So you see, this should be the same to be composable, and you compose. T prime compose T in T N R, and you just make the vertical concatenation. So something like that, maybe something like that. And you have something like that. Yeah. I will remove that. Okay. So you see, this is not, this is really, really intuitive. So what is very interesting for this example? So you have, so this is, a monoidal category, and the objects are not set. This is an example which is purely categorical, and in fact, such examples are closer to the what should be a generic example of a monoidal category. I expect that most of the monoidal category do not have model we've set. Anyway. Okay. So that's the end of the summary of last semester's course 4. So now we can summarize the last semester course 5. And it should be, let me see. So we will restart with some definition in monoidal category. So now summary of last semester course 5. Okay. So now we will talk about monoidal functor. So we know what is a monoidal category. We know that what is a functor, but there are specific functors for monoidal category called monoidal functor. So it's a functor with some additional axiom. Monoidal functor. Between two monoidal categories. So you have one monoideal category and another monoideal category. That. So a monoideal functor between two monoideal categories is a couple FG where F is just a functor, is a functor, and G is a natural isomorphism the following natural isomorphism. So you start from the functor. So it's a natural isomorphism between two functors from C cross Z, C cross C to C prime. C cross C to C prime. So you have two functors like that. So the following functor, X, Y map to F of X tensor F of Y, and the other functor, X, Y maps to F of X tensor Y. Okay. So of course we will have some additional action, right? So then recall that then the natural isomorphism is given by a collection of isomorphism. For all x, y in C, j, x, y. You have this isomorphism. F, x. And you have also the commuting diagram of a natural transformation. So we explained that last week again. Okay. So we have, we will deal with this notation JXY to explain the axiom that should satisfy J and F to be a monoidal functor. So to be a monoidal functor, in fact, it should avoid any ambiguity. So to avoid any ambiguity, in fact, some diagram should commute to avoid ambiguity. So satisfying the following two axioms made to avoid any ambiguity. Okay. So the unit axiom and the second one will be the monoidal structure axiom. So the unit axiom say that F of one is isomorphic to the one of the other category, one prime. So in other words, there exists an isomorphism between, so we write in this order because we will need this between one prime and F of one. Isomorphism. We will need to be from one prime to F of one later. And second axiom, the monoidal structure axiom. Moins noyau structure axiom. For all x, y. In C, the following commute. Following diagram commute. So this is a diagram to remove ambiguity. So what kind of ambiguity can we have? So assume you start from that. And you make so one possibility is to apply the associativity constraint directly, the associativity constraint of this of the C prime f of z, and then you just change the parenthesis f of y, f of z. Okay, but you can also apply. You can also apply the isomorphism J here and identity here. You can do that. So you can apply this. What you can do is you can all what you can do, and what you get is like that. And then here, now here, you can also apply J and identity, but the first identity for the first component and J here. Identity for f of x and j of yz. And what you get is f of x tensor prime f of y tensor z. Okay. Now, we can apply here J of X tensor Y Z, or we can apply here J of X Y tensor Z, and you get F of X tensor Y tensor Z, and here you get F of X tensor Y tensor Z. Almost the same thing with just a difference of parentheses. And you can go from one to the other by applying the associativity constraint mapped as the image of the associativity constraint by the functor f, a, x, y, z. So, you have this ambiguity. You can go from there to there by two ways. And to remove this ambiguity, the monoidal functor should assume that this is the same thing. So this comment. Okay. So what time is it? So it's almost time for the pause. Now, remark. So you start from okay. So you have You have two monoidal category, and you have a functor f. And the question is there a monoidal structure for this functor? So is there some J satisfying all this axiom? The question is, sometimes they can have several non-equivalent, or sometimes there is nothing. So a functor can have zero or one or several non-equivalent monoidal structure. So we will see example later. With several non-equivalent monoidal structure. Okay. So let's take now the theorem about the monoidal structure. A monoidal functor and how a monoidal functor deal with one. So you have extra ambiguity. So to solve, extra ambiguity involving the unit object, you have the following theorem. There is a canonical isomorphism phi from one prime to f of one, such that, so we said before that there is an isomorphism, but in fact there is a, this is a unit axiom, but in fact there is a specific one you can find a specific one removing this such the ambiguity. So what kind of ambiguity? So you start from that. Here you apply this morphism, the morphism removing the one prime on the left, or you apply phi and then identity. And here you get F1, tensor F1. Here you apply the image of, in fact, the inverse. So let me be more clear. So here you apply J11, the monoidal structure, and you are like that. And you can go from there to there by applying the image of the morphism L1 but we want to go on the other side, but we know it is an isomorphism. Here we just do the inverse like that. So this commute. So we can find a phi removing the ambiguity. So we proved that last semester. So there is a good choice of such a phi. So what time is it? 3 minutes. Okay. So let me write the last remark before the pause. So above commuting diagram. Can be generalized with where so we will generalize as I follow. We will replace all the one by a generic object X. So all this one here, this one, can be, so we can replace all this one by some X. So we can generalize. And there is also an analogous with the right morphism R instead of the left one. And in other words, so we can replace one by X. So this will be one commuting diagram, and also R by L by R, this will be another commuting diagram. So in other words, and we will see that after the pause. So pause. Okay. So we will rewrite this diagram. Replacing the one by X, and then we will provide the right version. So quickly, so one prime tensor F of X, L prime F of X. F of LX inverse, F of one tensor X. Phi identity F of X, F one tensor. F1x. So this one commute, and the right version, so fx tensor prime 1 prime r prime f of x here identity F of X tensor prime, F of X tensor prime F one X J X one F X tensor one, and here F of R X inverse. So commute. So in other words, for all x in C, the following diagram commute. Okay. So this is okay. And the remark here is that, in fact, this diagram, these two diagrams, is the former way, the usual way, but instead the older way, to define a monoidal functor. And in fact, in the book we are covering, we are using the unit axiom, which can provide the easier way to define monoidal functor. So a monoidal functor can alternatively be defined as a triple FJ phi satisfying monoidal structure axiom and the two commuting diagram table. But what? So the definition we gave following the book is simpler as don't assume the existence of phi. It is just proved to exist. So we don't need to assume the existence, we can prove this existence using the unit axiom. So it's okay. So convention. Now we have removed all the possible ambiguity. In fact, 1 and f of 1 can safely be identified. So we can simplify the structure. Once we made the good definition. Then so f1 equal 1 prime by identification, phi is just identity of 1 prime, and this monoidal structure are for 1x or x1 are just the identity of x. This is a convention to simplify the structure. There is no loss of generality here. It's just we just define everything properly in such a way that there is no possible ambiguity, so we can just make this simplification. Okay. So now we will define the notion of natural transformation of a monoidal functor. Natural transformation of monoidal functor. So how you can draw that? So you need two monomial catégorie. Si, like that, one monomial category and another monomial category, A prime, iota prime, you need two monomial functors between these two categories. So you have one monomial functor and another monomial functor. And the natural transformation between these two monomial functors will be an arrow like that. Satisfying some, of course, satisfying some extra assumption. So with, so you have eta, it's a natural transformation. So natural transformation is not just an arrow. Natural transformation between two functors. So it's a natural transformation between two functors. And in fact, it will be a natural transformation between the two monoidal functors with the following extra assumption. So you have an isomorphism for the unit object. But we know by convention that this is equal to one prime. This is equal to one prime. This is a convention. And the following, and finally, and the following diagram commute, following diagram commute for all x, y, and c. So what is the diagram that I'm talking about? Again, it's a diagram made to remove ambiguity. So there is an ambiguity about this natural transformation of monoidal category. The ambiguity is the following. So you start from there. One, F, it's not a prime, it's a one. So you can apply the monoidal structure X, Y. Or you can apply the natural transformation. So the isomorphism coming from, so the coefficient of of morphism coming with the natural transformation. And now you are in the two so it should be two as a prime. Okay. So wait, what is prime? What is one? F1, F2. Okay. So here it's really a prime. It's not a one. F2. And G2, so here it's a one. It's a one. G2XY, F2X tensor Y. You apply the monoidal structure, but you can also apply the natural transformation. So you have this ambiguity. So this ambiguity is removed because it commutes. So this is the same thing. Okay. So this is a definition of a natural transformation of monoidal functor. This is the end of last semester course 5. Now we can start summary of last semester course 6. And we will provide example of monoidal functor and natural transformation between monoidal functor. Example of monoidal functor and natural transformation between okay, so first example come from group theory. So let F from H to G be a finite group morphism, so a morphism between two finite groups. So I put finite between parentheses because maybe you don't need finite, but I don't care. So so the following, F star with star on the top and F index star are monoidal functors. Monoidal functor. So what about F star and F index star? So what about the first one? So note that the restriction of a representation V of G to the subgroup F of H so provide a representation of H. The representation of H and notation so the following, so F star, you start from the representation of G and you get a representation of H via the morphism, group morphism F. So it's F star like that. So this is the notation. Okay. So what about F index now, index star? This will be the same, but not using representation, but graded space. J graded space. So this F star is a monoidal functor. And the next one will be also a monoidal functor. So let W be H graded vector space. Now we start with an object related to H. Before we started with an object related to G. We went from G to H, and now we will go, this is a dual in fact, we will go from H to G. So let W be an H graded vector space. H graded, as I said last week, this is the vector space decomposed into according to the group. So it is, you can note that it is also G graded as follow. So it can be decomposed according to G, where you will use the map, use the morphism F. Make the sum of every H in the inverse image of F, of G, for G. So for every H such that F of H equal G. Like that. This is the G component, this will be the G component of the J gradient like that. And notation, so this will be noted. F with the star on the bottom of that. From vec H to vec G, so H graded to the G graded. Okay. So these two are monoidal functors. Now, let us provide another example of monoidal functor, and more precisely, in fact, we'll provide a trivial example of monoidal functor, but a non-trivial example of natural transformation between these two. So let S be a monoid consider the category, monoidal category, vec S. So S graded vector space, it's a monoidal category. So the identity functor, IDC is a monoidal functor where the monoidal structure is trivial. But what about the classification of the natural transformation between from IDC to itself? Now the natural transformation of monoidal functor. So eta from identity C to itself. So E is completely characterized. So it's a full classification. It's completely characterized by A map by a map eta tilde from the monoid to the field. With some additional structure, we will write because for S in S consider the simple object. And you consider the isomorphism, the morphism like that. This morphism between the two simple by Schur theorem, this is nothing but K identity like that. So for any element S here, you associate a scalar. So it's given by a map like that. And this is the Schur. This equality comes from Schur. This is a Schur lemma. Schur's lemma. Or homomorphism of simple between simple objects. So it's given by a map. This map, we put this name. And so this map such that phi tilde is a morphism of monoid. And by when I say it's completely characterized, this means so completely characterized. This means that if you start from any such monoid morphism of monoid, then you get a natural transformation. From a natural transformation of monoid functor between identity C to itself, you get a morphism of monoid between S and K, and from any morphism of monoid, you get the natural transformation, so it's a complete characterization. For a natural transformation, monoidal between two trivial monoidal functors, but you see, even if the monoidal functors are trivial, the natural transformation are not trivial. In fact, it's a morphism, monoid morphism. Okay. Okay. So now, what about monoidal functor between two monoidal categories vec du omega? We define just at the beginning of this session. So here I am. I am just writing the result. In fact, we proved last semester, we investigate all the definition to find the complete characterization of such object. So monoidal functor between some vec G1 omega 1 n vec g2 omega 2. So what is a it is completely characterized. We have a complete characterization as before. It is completely characterized by two maps, F and phi, so the functor and so that such functor is denoted F like that. So what is this two map? So where F is a group morphism. And phi, it's a map from G1 cross G2 to the non-zero scalar such that we have two property. Property one, the monoidal structure is exactly given by this map identity delta FGH, and we have the following equality. So phi of G HL, phi of HL, omega 2 of F of G, F of H, F of L equal omega 1, G HL, phi G H L, G, so G H L, phi G H. For all G H L in G1. Okay. So this is a complete characterization of monoidal functor between these two monoidal categories. So this is what we did for course 6 last semester. So now we can summarize of last semester course 7. I should say session, in fact, not course, because session 7. Course should be session, it's more exact. It's a session 7 of the last semester course. Anyway, it does not matter. So so in course 7, what we did, we completely characterized the natural monoidal transformation between this monoidal functor. Again, it's a complete characterization of some notion we introduce. So to make this complete characterization, it's a good exercise to better understand the notion. So the natural monoidal. So natural monoidal transformation, this is the same thing as natural transformation of monoidal category. Natural monoidal transformation eta from two such monoidal functors. F. So first, if such eta exists, then F equal F prime. Non-zero. Yes, we need non-zero. So non-zero. If non-zero, such okay, different from zero exists, then F is equal F prime and eta G is an isomorphism. Okay. And then it is completely characterized. Again, a map eta tilde from G1 to the non-zero scalar. So as before, eta G equal eta tilde of G identity F of G. Same idea as before. Okay. Such that you have the following equality. Eta tilde GH phi G comma H is phi prime G comma H eta tilde G times eta tilde H. Like that. Okay. So it's a complete characterization of such not monoidal transformation. So by above result, the three cocycle omega for vec J omega can be taken normalized without loss of generality. So we will explain what we mean by normalized just now. So without, this means without, if I don't know, without. Loss of generality. Generality. So what I mean by germ normalized? So we can assume that G1H equal 1 for all GH in G. G is a cyclic group, we mean with a singly generated, a single one generator n g, such that g power n is a trivial. So the cyclic group of order n then so if so in the cyclicless in the cyclic case so then there exists I need a bit more room. I don't want to change the page for that. Then there exists an integer n between n between 0 and an integer s between 0 and n such that omega is omega s with omega s of g a g b GC equal exponential 2 pi I over n s a s time s time a time the integral part also called floor of b plus c over n. I guess should be up to equivalence, of course, maybe up to equivalence. So I will put a question mark because I'm not 100% sure that it is a complete character. This is a complete classification. So I guess you can have two models like that which are equivalent. But what I'm not completely sure is whether every in the cyclic case we can always reduce to such three cocycle. So that's why I put a question mark. But at least this is a good class of example. Okay. Okay, so now. Now it's almost done. Okay. So I guess we will. We are almost done. So I will write the title of what we will do next session. Sorry. Restart from here. next session, next time, we will start by defining the notion of group action of categories and equivariantization. This should correspond to, let me check the book. I'll remind you 1 or 2 minutes. Group action on category, not off category. Group action on categories and equivariantization. And this is the book. This corresponds to the book subsection. The book tensor category by Itting of Gilakin, Chish, Ostrich. Subsection 2.7. Okay. So now I am done for today. So we can stop here and see you next time. So if you have questions, you can post questions on the WeChat group. So the video recording will be, and the slide will be on the WeChat group very soon. Also on YouTube very soon. So see you next time. Bye.